Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That's good. Some things never change. Right? Yeah, thank God. Some things never change. God never changes. You know, as that's great. Great job. Thank you, Sister Trick, Brother Randy, Sister Tiffany. Thank you. Very good. You know, even as we were sitting there during that song, my uncle reminded me that that was my mother's, well, one of my mother's favorite songs, How Great Thou Art. Anybody heard that song before? You know, and when you said that, I was reminded of a story my mother told me. My Uncle Charlie was a preacher. And when my Uncle Charlie would preach, of course, plenty of the family would be there when he preached, but my mother would be in the audience at times, and he would give, my Uncle Charlie would play and sing, but he didn't have a large repertoire. So he would tell my mother, when I shout out on any request, you shout out How Great Thou Art. That's the only song he knew. I just remember that story. I'll tell you what. Oh man, it's hard to find an honest preacher. Good to have you all here. Amen. All right. All right. We're glad to have you. You know, and all you who came for breakfast, God bless you. All those who cooked and participated, God bless you. And you know, even on this day, I know that there are a lot of friends and family here today, and wherever you traveled from, we're very glad you're here. You know, we're really glad you're here. And you know, we have our breakfast the second Sunday of every month, and we do like to consider it. I like to consider it our casual Sunday. You know, I love the atmosphere of having breakfast and then coming into the sanctuary. I do find it to be a more relaxed atmosphere, so I hope you experience and appreciate that as well. So, you know, with the message today, I would like to keep the message really simple. And I believe that's what Jesus Christ himself did, you know? I believe man complicates things, but Jesus always came to simplify things. Doesn't it intrigue you that the King of all kings, the God of all creation, he didn't come as a king, he didn't come as an emperor, he came as a carpenter's son. You know, does that intrigue you? He was the creator of everything that was, that is, and that will be. Yet from the outward appearance, he wouldn't seem to be the most brilliant of men or the most influential of men, but he created everybody who was brilliant and influential. I'm so reminded of Billy Graham when I speak of Christ in his simplicity. Billy Graham, of course, was a college graduate, but he said the average American only has like a 1,500 word vocabulary, so he made sure that he spoke with simplicity. Jesus Christ spoke with simplicity. Mankind, we take things and we make it complicated. As if we can, like, you know, make it seem intellectual, it's like, oh wow, it's high and lofty. Probably too high and lofty, I don't want to go. There's simplicity in Jesus Christ. Isn't that nice? Yeah. So with the message today, you know, might go in depth a little more on a Wednesday, but in your bulletin, you see the title of today's message. Today's message is, anybody see it there? Divine nature. Divine nature. I want to talk about the divine nature today, even in contrast with something that we spoke on Wednesday just past, in regard to the nature of the beast, or the image of the beast. So, if you would, and if you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 1, and we'll read two verses. Now we'll read three. We'll read 2 through 4. And I'm going to read from the NIV. I think it's the NIV. I don't know. 2. Grace and peace be yours in abundance. How? Through the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ our Lord. Isn't it wonderful that grace and peace Peace is multiplied to you through the knowledge of God. Grace is multiplied to you through the knowledge of God. That's one of the reasons why we pursue Him. It brings peace in our lives. It brings peace in the world. Verse 3 says, His divine power has given us everything we need for life. Life and godliness through, once again, our knowledge of Him. Our knowledge of God, who called us by His own glory and goodness. Verse 4. Through these, He has given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate. Does anybody know what we can participate in? His divine nature. Hallelujah. And escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. We have read and we have talked and spoken that we are able to not only participate, that word participate really has a greater meaning to it. It means that we partake in it. It's part of who we are. Do you know that you, your nature is comprised of the divine nature? Sometimes you see things like that and that might seem too lofty. Maybe in certain ways you say it, you might think, well, how can you say that? How dare anyone even say that? But I always love the simplicity of it is this. If I am His child, is anyone else the child of God?
Yes.
Okay, all of us, thank you. If we are all the children of God, then whatever He is, we are. We came from Him. Yeah. You with me? I remember even Paul, when he went out to speak to the Corinthians were a Greek city, and they were the intellectuals, and Paul would go to the intellectuals, and he would tell them something like this. He would say, listen, we are the offspring of God. Which is the greatest thing anyone can be. We're the offspring of God. So of course, part of our DNA, part of our spiritual makeup is this, the divine nature. Does anybody know any of the attributes of God? Yes is a safe answer. Love? Does anybody love? Yeah. That's the divine nature. Yeah. God is?
Joy.
That's great.
Grace.
Peace.
Amen.
Meekness, kindness, gentleness.
Yeah, now we got to flow. Faithfulness.
God is great.
Say it again.
God is great.
All right.
Almighty.
Yeah. Who said that? You said Almighty, right?
That's right.
And we are the mighty ones. Yeah. The divine nature. It's in each inside. It's inside each and every one of us. And the truth of the matter is, everybody who has breath in their lungs has the divine nature inside them. Because breath came upon this planet and inside mankind, the very breath that we breathe is the breath of God. Does everybody have breath yet?
Yes.
What a silly question. Then you have the divine nature. Sister Heather, all aboard?
Yes.
Listen, I just want to give us a few simple truths today. Number one, everybody who has breath has the divine nature. All right? Okay, I'm with you. Now, when I read things like this, you know, I'm reminded of, and I was brought to a remembrance of Hebrews. In our Bible study, we're in the book of Hebrews, and if you'll allow me, and if you'd like to turn to Hebrews chapter 1, you know, usually I don't turn to verses or that many verses, but I'd like to turn to a couple today. Hebrews chapter 1, and I want to look at the first three verses, okay? I want to read them in the King James Version, and Hebrews 1:1 is one of my favorite verses in Scripture. Hebrews 1:1 in the King James Version. I like the words used in the King James Version. But if you're with me, the first verse. Does anybody know the first word, the first verse of the King James Version?
God.
Yeah, God. God. I like how it starts off. God. Okay? You know, Let me pull your attention from the pages of your Bible now. You know that there's we talked in our Bible study on Friday that the author of Hebrews is unknown. Does anybody, any theologians in the house, done some studying before? Oh, am I talking fast or are you just out with me? Okay, Bible 101. Nobody really knows for sure who the author of Hebrews is, and there's many guesses to who the author of Hebrews may be. Now, I'm not going to ask you, please don't throw out your guesses, because I think in pursuit of the guesses, we lose who the real author of Hebrews is, because I believe the author of Hebrews is the first word of the first verse. What's the first word of the first verse?
God.
And I think that's what God wants us to know. He wrote the book. He's the author. And I think this book is so special in so many ways that we'll get into a little bit more. But God is the author of the book. So let's stop chasing man. You know what I find in the book of Hebrews? We chase man instead of God. A lot of times we chase man. Well, who do you think the author is? Well, I think according to the writings and the style, I think it's Paul. I'm not making fun of anybody. I'm sorry. I think it's Luke. I think it's Apollos. I think it's Cephas. The first word in the first verse, who wrote it?
God.
That's what he wants you to know. For one moment in time, he wants you to stop looking at man and look to God. Stop identifying with man and all his characteristics. Oh, Paul was a strong man. Paul was a rugged man. Peter was a tough man. How about God? Does anybody want to be like God? Yeah. You can be like Peter. You can be like Paul. You can be like James. You can be like Tom. But don't you want to be like God? All right. We're getting off track here. God wrote the book. God wrote the book. There's a reason why we don't know the author, or we think we don't know the author. I believe the author is written right here, the first verse, God. Okay, King James, God. Who at sundry times and divers manners spoke in times past unto the fathers by the prophets. Verse 2. Hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son. A.K.A. God, his Son. They're both the authors. Who's the author? A Son of God is the author. I see you see the author right at the beginning of the book. Why are we chasing man? But I think it's interesting because I think we chase man more than we think we do. Okay. So, spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, and who he made the worlds. That was the song we sang. Some of the lyrics. Verse 3. Who being the brightness of his glory, how about the next words, and the express image of his person, who was? Jesus, the pattern son. And upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, thank you, Jesus, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Amen.
Amen.
I want us to see this in the book of Hebrews. This is what I want us to see. I want us to see that according to the book of Hebrews, I believe Hebrews wants to start to point us to God and his Son. I believe through this book of Hebrews, I believe the primary focus is to get us to understand who we are. We are children of God. We are supposed to identify with God. Always identify with God. And that's the divine nature. All too often, we don't live in the potential of our divine nature because we don't identify with God. Sometimes we think it's too lofty. I can identify myself with you. I can gladly identify myself with you. Brother, they're going to pick on you today. I'll identify myself with you because I look good compared to you. I'm sorry. No, he looks good compared to me. Now, you can mock me all. You know you all do the same thing. Come on now. We like to compare ourselves to man because compared to man, we're doing pretty good sometimes. Yeah! Yeah. That's most of the reason why we put folks down because then we look better. I believe God wants us to stop identifying with man. With your natural life and your natural self when you're just flesh and blood and a human being, and identify with just a natural life that you live. I wake up in the morning, I do this. This is my short-term goal, my long-term goal. God wants us to stop identifying with man. Man, you need to identify with God. Do you know when God created Adam and Eve in the very beginning? God created Adam. And after Adam named all the animals, you know Adam named all the animals, right? After he named all the animals, Adam said to God, okay, I see they come to me two by two, but Adam said, but where's mine? Where's mine? I believe the picture there is this. God said, I'm yours. You were created for me. Oh, but we didn't see it. God said, you're my equal. I breathe my breath inside of you. You and me, we're the same. I created you in my image and my likeness. And from the very beginning, Adam said, but I don't see my equal. And God said, I'm standing right in front of you. We, from the beginning, we didn't identify with who we are. You are made in the express image of God. You're made in the image of God. You have a divine nature. Who? I'm sorry, that was not a clear question. Who has a divine nature? Anybody with breath? Anybody with breath? Uh-huh. And I see that here in the book of Hebrews. I believe God is causing us to awaken to our Father, our being created in the image and likeness of God. You are His crown creation, the most glorious thing He has ever created. And then He breathed His life, His nature, all His substance inside of you. It's the divine nature. Hallelujah. Yeah. You know, Hebrews, we talked a little on Friday. Hebrews. The word Hebrew in Scripture, Abraham was the first person ever to be called a Hebrew. Abraham was the first Hebrew. And from him, of course, he gave birth to a nation called the Hebrews or the Israelites. Amen? Yeah. And the reason why he was called a Hebrew, the word Hebrew means one who crosses over. The word Hebrew means one who crosses over. What did Abraham cross over? You know, you and your brother. We'll put you on the spot. He crossed over the Euphrates River. He was in the land of Mesopotamia. God called him to leave his country, to leave his family. Does anybody know the story? Yeah. I'm just playing with you. Does anybody know the story? Yeah. All right. God called Abraham and said, leave your family, leave your country. I'm calling you to something absolutely brand new. So he caused him to cross over the river Euphrates into the promised land. He was the first to cross the river. Hebrew means one who crosses over. Yeah. He crossed over from, we can go on, from death to life. He crossed over from an old world to a new world. Yeah. He crossed over. Another word for crossover is an overcomer. He was the first representative of Christ himself, who would be the first one to cross over from death to life. That's, you know, we call it the born-again experience, right? We call it being Christian, right? That's what we call one who crosses over from death to life. I've laid down my life, I've accepted his life, right? I'm born again, I'm a new man, new woman, whatever you'd like to be. Every time I say man, it's really gender neutral, you know that. So, the Hebrew is the one who crosses over. Now, who's the author of the book of Hebrews? God or the Son of God? Who is he writing to? The Hebrews. He's writing to the crosser overs. He's writing to those who probably have not yet crossed over. He's writing to those who probably still think they're just natural. They just have a natural life and they have natural understandings. He's talking to people who still relate themselves to men. And he's saying this. He says, you got to cross over. You got to cross over. Stop identifying with man, identify with God. Stop living in an old world, live in a new world. The first Hebrew was Jesus Christ himself, and then he calls to the other Hebrews because he was the first one among many brethren, right? Yes. And he calls out to his family. He says, I've been through it. Come on over. Come on over. Amen. Come on. He says, why don't you identify with me? Even Jesus Christ in scriptures tells us that we're his brother. Full brother. Full brother. Isn't that something? Jesus Christ became the Son of Man so that the sons of men could become sons of God. His full brother. But I see in the book of Hebrews this. I see that Jesus Christ was the first one who crossed over. He was the first one who took on the form of flesh and blood to walk the earth and say this, I am the Son of God. He was the first. The scripture tell you that?
Yes.
He was the first. I'll give you some scriptures in a moment. He was the first. But then he says to the rest of you, you are the sons of God. You are the children of God. Come on over. Come on over. Colossians 1:15 says, Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God. He is the firstborn of every creature. And then Romans 8:29 says this. It says, for whom God did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that Jesus Christ might be, does anybody know the rest? That he might be the firstborn among many brothers. What did Jesus do when he walked the earth? Jesus did stuff like this. He says, me and the Father, we're one. Who did he identify with? God. He would say stuff like this, crazy stuff. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Because they would come up to him, Jesus, show me the Father. Like someone coming up to you. Richard, show me the Father. Show me the Father. And if Richard ever said to me, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, I'll be completely out of it. Completely out of it. See, the divine nature is us identifying with God. That's who we are. You can walk the earth and you can say, the Father and I were one. He loves, I love. He forgives, I forgive. He brings peace, I bring peace. You all right? You all right with that? Yeah. It's called the divine nature. Yeah, that's right. Okay, so I just wanted to show you that scripture does tell us that he was the firstborn among many brethren. Now, I digress. I will have to bring you to the book of Revelation now, Revelation chapter 15. And forgive me, but I'm going to have to bring the beast nature on the scene now. You have to. All right. In Revelation chapter 15, we talked about this on Wednesday. We talked about the beast on Wednesday. Has anybody ever heard stories about the beast?
Yes.
Yeah. I've heard Beauty and the Beast. Is that what you're talking about? Yeah. Most of us have heard about the stories of the beast in Revelation. The nature of the beast. What we said on Wednesday, Revelation 15, if you'll allow me, I know I'm reading some scriptures today, but allow me two more. Verse 1 says, I saw a wonder in heaven, great and marvelous. Seven angels having the seven last plagues, for in them the wrath of God is complete. We spoke on this on Wednesday. And I saw something like a sea of glass mingled with fire. And those who have victory over the beast. And then the beast was broken down into three components. Over his image. Over his mark. Does anybody know the last one? Over the number of his name. Standing on the sea of glass. And having harps with God. What we see here in this book here is God is going to cause us to overcome the beast. His mark, his image, and his number. How? How? By causing us to understand that we have a divine nature. The moment you understand that you have a divine nature, that beast is destroyed. Because who is the beast? The beast is the carnal nature. I'll tell you, I told you I want to keep it simple. We can make it as difficult as you want. But the beast is this. It's the one who doesn't believe they have a divine nature. Is that simple enough? Yeah. The beast is the one who does not believe they have a divine nature. Interesting, isn't it? I got one amen, but I have to just sit here. Now, Ecclesiastes 3:18 says this. All right. I said in my heart concerning the estate of the sons of men, not the sons of God, the sons of men. Because Ecclesiastes is a book about really the fallen creature, one who lives under the sun. Is anybody familiar with the book of Ecclesiastes?
Amen.
It was Solomon who wrote the book. It was really Solomon in his backslid of a fallen state. And he talked about all the woes of life and all the cycles of life and how everything under the sun was nothing but vanity, vanity, all is vanity. It was somebody who was really living without the knowledge of the glorious divine nature. So he saw everything as vanity. Is this life full of vanity? Of course not. But sometimes we think that, don't we? Don't answer that. The beast thinks that. The beast thinks that. The one who lives without God. Okay. So, I said in my heart concerning the estate of the sons of men, that God might manifest them, that they might see that they themselves are beasts. Some of you know this scripture. And there's many scriptures sprinkled throughout the Bible. And I want you to see this. The beast is the one who lives without God. The beast is man without God. The beast is man without God. Or the divine nature. Now, according to what you said to me earlier, everybody who has breath has God. So the truth is this, forgive me if I'm speaking in riddles, but no one is without God. There is not one soul upon the earth who is without God. It's impossible. It's impossible, that's right. If you've got breath inside you, you have God. And let me tell you something, and if I can clear it up a little bit. There have been times in our Christian walk where we thought that God was far from us. Has anyone ever thought that God was far from us? Has anyone ever thought that God left them for a season and there was divine purpose in it? Yeah. Come on. Has anyone felt that they walked through the darkest of darkness?
Yeah.
Spiritually speaking. I know I haven't, I know probably all of you have.
Yeah.
You ever go out on a starless night sometimes in certain areas? I have, and you put your hand in front of your face and you can't even see your hand in front of your face. Has anyone ever experienced something like darkness like that? I remember I was upstate one time and there was no stars out at night. I put my hand right in front. I couldn't even see my hand in front of my face. That's how dark it was. But there have been times in your spiritual life and mine where we have experienced such darkness. And we have thought that God was far, far from us. But the truth is God was always inside of you. Outside of you. He was the breath that you breathe. He's everything. But we thought that we were without God. So I want you to know this. Man is never without God. We just think we're without God. We just think we're without God. That's the beast nature. The beast nature is when we think we're without God. It's when we think that God has left us. It's when we think for some reason that God's angry with us. It's when we think that he's disappointed. And you know, every one of us have lived a part of our lives where we have thought for sure that God was angry with us, that God was teaching us a lesson, that God was somehow disappointed that you and I would hear if I could just say the words from God, well done, thou good and faithful servant. The beast is the one who lives without God, but not really. Not really. You just think you're without God. Isn't that something? Yeah, I find that to be something. So, you know, the brute beast is man without God, but no man can ever really be without God. He can only think that he's without God. Now, you remember when, I found this interesting. You remember when Jesus Christ was on the cross and some of the last things that he would say? As a matter of fact, he said, there was one statement that he said, I believe it was in Latin. He said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. Does anybody remember that one? Translated, it means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Okay, everybody awake for like 10 more minutes? Okay, by that response, I got half of you. Give me 10 more minutes. 10 more minutes. Otherwise, we stop feeding him before church. I promise you, we stop feeding him. Okay, come on. Come on. On the cross, Jesus Christ said, what did he say? My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? You know what the beast does or man does without God? We identify with that statement. We identify, oh, I know Jesus, I know. Because there's times in your life that you might have said the same thing because you said, I'm just like God. My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That doesn't reconcile with other scriptures that says, I will, God says, I will never what? Leave you or forsake you. Which one is true? That's a nice response. Which one is true? What you think. What you think is true to you, but not actually true. On the cross, Jesus said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And you and I identify that part with God. But this is what I see. That's not where we identify with God. That's where Jesus Christ is identifying with you. He's identifying with you in your fallen state. When you thought that God has forsaken you, he took on the image of fallen man. He took on your sinful nature. Why? To bring you back to God. He brought you to the place where you thought that God had forsaken you, where you thought that you were just a man, where you thought that God was not inside of you. He took on your image. He took on your likeness. He spoke your very words for you. And he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? The truth is, he never forsook you. He never left you. He was always with you. Before the cross, after the cross, before the world was, after the world will be. Always, always, always. Because remember some of the other things Jesus said on the cross. He said, Father. Yes, he said that too. He said several things. He said, Father, into thy hands do I commit my spirit. What I see on the cross is Jesus, who is very much man and very much God. He took on the nature of man so that you could take on the nature of God. And for you and I to come to a depth of that understanding, for you and I to become a Hebrew, to cross over a river, to transfer from death to life and realize this, my God has never left me and my God has never forsaken me. My God has always been inside of me and outside of me and on top of me and below me. He has ever heard every word that, always heard every word that I have ever said, every prayer I have ever cried. He has always been with me. Yeah. And in that moment, my nature is changed from the nature of the beast to the divine nature. The nature of the beast is the one who thinks that God is not with him, and that's not even true. You just think that God is not with you. It's impossible for him not to be with you.
That's right.
You just thinking that he's not with you is the beast nature. You knowing that he is with you, the divine nature. The divine nature. The beast is man without God. You can never be without God. You can only think you're without God. Now, will any of you admit, because I will admit, in my darkest day, now that the dark day has passed, maybe some of you are still in it, I know God is with me. God was in my dark day. What on earth makes me think I ever could have got through it without him? Many of you have talked to me about the footprints in the sand over the last couple. Where we have prayed the prayer, God, where were you? Where were you? Some of you might be saying that right now in your lives. You might be saying, God, where are you? Where are you? That's not the divine nature. Where am I? He says, every time you breathe in, there I am. Every time you take a step, there I am. Where am I? I'm the one who holds you together. I'm the one who somehow miraculously makes sure you get up in the morning and put your clothes on before you walk out the door. Can't promise you breakfast, but I know he'll get some clothes on you before you walk out that door. Uh-huh. my God, why hast thou forsaken me? No. Those are the words of fallen men. Lord, into thy hand will I commit my spirit, my life. Your life, every breath that you breathe is in the hands of your God. Although it doesn't feel like it at times, it doesn't seem like it at times, you can never, ever be separated from the love of God. For what shall separate us from the love of God? Shall death or life? Angels or demons? Depth or height? What's the rest of that? Nothing. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. The divine nature is this. You know and darn sure that God is with you every moment of your life. This nature is the one who doesn't know it. Let me just close with a verse. Maybe 2 Thessalonians. 2 Thessalonians, chapter 2, verse 8. You don't have to turn it. I'll be very happy to read it. How is the nature of the beast destroyed? That beast that you all read about in Revelation, the beast is just the one who thinks that God's not with them. How do you destroy that nature so that we can live in the divine nature? I think of this passage in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 8, and this is how it reads. It says, some of you might know it. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. Does anybody, someone familiar with that passage by raising hands? Anybody? Okay. In this passage here, this passage is talking about the son of perdition. Anyone ever hear the son of perdition? The man of sin? Who will be revealed in the end time? It's talking about the beast nature. It's talking about the one who is without God, or just thinking without God. So how do we destroy the beast? How do we destroy this nature, this man of sin? How do we destroy it? It's very simple. It says, the Lord shall consume him, consume with the spirit of his mouth, and destroy with the brightness of his coming. God will destroy the beast with the brightness of his coming. The moment that you realize that God is with you, the beast is destroyed. Because the beast is the one who doesn't believe that. Is that simple enough? Is it too simple? You can say yes. That's it. The moment that you believe that God is with you, the beast is destroyed. Because the beast doesn't believe that. Do you believe that God is with you?
Yes.
Great. Oh, mission accomplished. Okay, great. What's for lunch? All right, thank you, brother. What's for lunch? Amen. I'm on. What's for lunch? It's the only amen I got in my brother. What's for lunch? How about the Christmas verse? Behold, the virgin shall be with child. And shall bring forth a, take a wild guess, a son, a crosser over, an overcomer. Mm-hmm. And they shall call his name,
Jesus.
Yes, yes, Jesus, yes. And Emmanuel, which being interpreted is, what? Say it again.
God with us.
Well, you have the divine nature. You have the divine nature. We all stand with me. Anyone with the divine nature, please come.